ask if you had just one question. And yeah, yeah, God is great. Yeah, yeah, God is good. Yeah, 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 yeah. What if God was one of us? Just a slob like one of us. Just a stranger on the bus trying to make his way. What would it look like, and would you want to see? If seeing meant that you would have to believe in things like heaven and in Jesus and the saints and all the prophets. And yeah, yeah, God is.
Must be Providence or something. It's funny, I tried to vary the music for the show according to the general material, at least, and Dave Ardern in Australia, who puts all this stuff up on YouTube usually the following day, is, you know, constantly informing me that either one other piece has been forbidden by Google, who of course owns YouTube, and by default this is the only music we've been able to use. So anyway, welcome again everyone to TNS Radio Ireland. Special hello again to our many new listeners from Facebook. You're listening to Mike Montagne, original 1968 architect of mathematically perfected economy, speaking on mathematically perfected economy and absolute consensual representation. Archives of this program can be downloaded freely at tnsradio.com from the category Mike Montagne and from the domain perfectedeconomy.org. Original material, analyses, and solution, as always, are copyrighted and trademarked by yours truly, Mike Montagne. All rights, and therefore claims of authority, are reserved. Copies of this program can be downloaded and distributed freely only so long as the entirety of this program, including this copyright and trademark notice, remain intact. Good to have you with us again. As we've explained, the perfection of economy is no challenging mathematic issue. In other words, if inflation and deflation are defined as increases or decreases in circulation per represented wealth, then of course, obviously, there is one and one only solution for inflation and deflation, and that is to maintain a circulation which at all times is equal to the remaining value of all represented property. And of course, likewise, it's a simple mathematic fact as well, not an opinion, but a fact, and a singular fact, because in mathematics, any mathematic riddle has one solution. There may be various expressions of that solution. Nonetheless, there is one solution. Whether it be a single integer, a real number, a definition, a set, a union, whatever, there is one and one only answer. Likewise, in fact, we've conclusively established that the only possible categoric faults of any prospective monetary thesis are comprised of either the volumetric improprieties we've just solved or dispositional improprieties, that is, interest in inherently multiplying sum of falsified indebtedness in proportion to a circulation disposes ever more of the circulation to sustaining or servicing the escalating sum of falsified debt as opposed to sustaining the industry which is compelled to service the debt. So, of course, the dispositional improprieties are solved by an eradication of interest, which, of course, is justified, as we've explained, in our unraveling of this obfuscation of the currency in which a mere publisher of evidence of our promissory obligations to each other falsifies or obfuscates our obligation to pay and retire principal into a falsified debt to the publisher, and whereupon the publisher, without actually having any commensurable lawful consideration at stake at all, imposes interest, which results in this implicit obligation then to maintain a vital circulation by perpetually borrowing principal and interest that we pay out of circulation back into circulation, with therefore the principal we borrow back into circulation comprising new debt equal to the former sum of debt which might otherwise be assumed to be resolved, therefore making it mathematically impossible to pay down any prior sum of debt, and with the interest we pay out of circulation and borrow back into circulation to reflate the circulation, therefore comprising new debt, and thus with a sum of debt, therefore inherently and irreversibly increasing so long as we maintain a vital circulation by so much as periodic interest on an ever greater sum of debt, with us thus suffering an escalated rate of failure until we suffer a terminal sum of debt which exceeds our creditworthiness to borrow further and would result in a natural pattern of failure of near immediate deflation of the circulation, as so much of the circulation was already dedicated to servicing the terminal sum of debt that we would pay the virtual entire circulation out of circulation in one fell swoop. So these are the causes of failure, and this is all that's necessary to perfecting mathematically perfected economy. These aren't matters of opinion. These aren't matters of, you know, that we can throw some fancy catchwords at and resolve these issues to something else. This isn't a matter of us imposing our worldview unjustly upon anyone else. These facts solve a crime against all of us. They are, in fact, then, on the contrary, an eradication of a falsified worldview which has been imposed upon all of us. And the result of this is effectively the monetary equivalent of barter. By eradicating exploitation, we've made it possible for ourselves to trade equal measures of our work for the work of others, the value of which is determined by the only possible truly free markets, because no such thing as a truly free market can exist under this obfuscation of the currency, which siphons away, which takes from us, which dispossesses us, which divests us of our own production to an ever-escalating extent until we are entirely divested of our production and even our means of production. So, this multiplication of falsified indebtedness by interest under this obfuscation of the currency is the cause, the fundamental cause, of the worldwide global failure. Thus, the failure is artificial. It is artificially imposed upon us by the intentional imposition of an intended system of exploitation, the means of exploitation of which happen to be terminal. So, any veritable mathematic analysis or perspective of economy, which is a mathematic issue, all of the expressions of which, while they may relate to justice, they may concur with justice, they may invalidate a fact of justice, nonetheless, all of the expressions are mathematic in nature, because economy, in the least, is an accounting system. Just economy, in fact, at most, is an accounting system, with, of course, the necessary provisions to ensure that, in fact, it replicates or sustains facts of monetary justice, such as, for instance, this predicates our obligatory schedule of payment, which solves inflation and deflation by retiring principal at the rate of consumption or depreciation of the related property. If we paid at a greater rate than this, we would be paying for what we haven't really received or consumed. And if we paid at a lesser rate, we would be paying for less than we have actually consumed. We would be acquiring something for free with no means of enforcing justice, that is, payment for what we've acquired, because the remaining value of the property is insufficient to make up the difference. So, in mathematically perfected economy, we've in fact resolved all of the issues, and for 43 years, I've been answering the questions over and over and over and over again. We're an audience is willing and capable of its own volition and intent to understand the issues. Of course, I've made myself available to answer questions, to be accessible for further explanation, to answer questions which people think have never been answered, yet which, in fact, I answer on a regular basis, in many cases 10